Good morning.
Welcome to a blustery, wintry Sunday. People to the north of us are having ice, and thank goodness we're not. But it is cold, it is damp, very brutal weather we're having. So this is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
A few announcements, if you notice on the screen. We have Adopt a Street. We're going to do a cleanup this coming Saturday. The Methodist men will meet at the Family Life Center at 9 o'clock. If you'd like to come and help, we'd love to have you. If the weather is bad, for whatever the reason, we'll postpone it till next Saturday. And if you notice, next Saturday we'll be at the Housleys helping them remove a tree that has some mold and mildew growing, and it is hurting Miss Housley's health. And we'll also meet, I guess, Philip up there at 9 o'clock at Gene and Sandy's. If you don't know how to get there, see me or Philip. Somebody will get you there. But we will be up there working. Also, the deadline for the newsletter is the 20th. So make sure you have Miss Tommy your information. Catawba Women Group, they'll be meeting on the 21st. I presume this will be here over in Explorers class. So come be a part of that group. And then don't forget about the Ash Wednesday service. It'll be held here in the sanctuary at 7 p.m. Yesterday we served, the men and the women served 34 plates of love to our shut-ins and those people that are needing a good warm meal. It's a great service, thanks to Debbie for helping put this together. But it was well received, thanks to the men, the women, and all other volunteers that helped put that together. We had a little young baker here in the church submit a bunch of fresh baked bread to put in those. And thank you to that young lady. She likes to be behind the scenes, so I'm not going to call her name, but you know who she is. The other thing, the pecans have been reduced. If you
They're
like
gone.
To have some pecans to eat.
They're gone.
They're gone. Well, forget that.
Yeah.
Nuts have left. Are there any other announcements? Well, I see in here this morning there is a young man in our presence that has turned 21 at least once in his life.
Yes.
Today is Ken Simmons' birthday. Happy birthday, young man. Donna, would you mind leading us up? Let's sing happy birthday to the young man.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Ken. Happy birthday to you.
That being said, I'll turn it over to Reverend King.
Thank you, sir. For participating in worship together. And thank you to everyone for your donation of food. I'd like to invite all of you for the call to worship and opening hymn and opening prayer, call to worship. Sing praises to God, all faithful people.
Shout to God's power and mercy.
The Lord has heard our cries.
The Lord has redeemed our souls.
Praise be to God.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Would you rise? Let's praise God together with the song, Trust and Obey.
I do his good.
our opening prayer.
Come, Holy One, teach us your ways. Lead us in your paths. Guide us on your journey. Speak to us your words of life, for you offer us direction and wholeness when we hear your voice and follow. You bless us with your love, shower us with your grace, help us grow in faith. We seek you, O God, with all our hearts. Be near us this day. Amen.
And as he taught us, so now we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. You may be seated. For this time, let's turn to our neighbors and wave each other and say, God loves you, and so do I.
God loves you, and so do I.
God loves you. I'd like to invite the children to come forward for the young Christian time. Donna, you better to speak, preach in Korean, please.
Does anybody know what today is? It's kind of a big day. People think it's a big day.
You know what it is?
Super Bowl.
It's Super Bowl Sunday. Now, to a lot of people, Super Bowl, to most people, Super Bowl Sunday is about a big, great big football game that they'll watch on TV, and lots of people will watch it. But to us, today is Super Bowl Sunday, S-O-U-P, like a can of soup. Super Bowl Sunday, I'm going to tell you a little bit about that in just a little bit, but that's why we have all these cans of food over here behind us. It's awesome. Thank you, everybody who donated the food. But today we're going to sing a song in worship that we usually only sing at Thanksgiving. But it's appropriate to use it today because it's Super Bowl Sunday. And the name of the song is Come Ye Thankful People, Come. And part of the first verse says, God, our Maker, doth provide for our wants to be supplied. Come to God's own temple, come, raise the song of harvest home. Now, what this really means is that God takes care of us, and He provides for us food and clothing and shelter, and we're very blessed to have those things. And to show our thankfulness for these things, we bring our gifts of food to help others. We have brought food into God's house as an offering for our thanks and praise to God for providing for us. I want to ask you a question. Is God going to eat this food? No. Who's going to eat this food?
Somebody.
Who's going to eat this food? No. Someone who's hungry? I just heard on the radio this week that there are one out of every six children in North Carolina goes hungry. And that means that maybe some children and friends of yours at school maybe come to school hungry. Or maybe they only eat food while they're at school and maybe they don't get to eat at home. That's very sad, isn't it? But we can do something about that. Now, the Super Bowl of Caring started in 1990, and I think it was by a youth group in South Carolina, and they just had this idea. They asked a question. They said, what if everyone watching the big game gave just $1 or one can of food to a local food charity? Just think. all the people that watch the football game, what if everybody just gave $1 for one can of food? That would be millions, wouldn't it? Millions. And that's exactly what's happened since 1990. This idea has just grown and grown and grown, and now churches and organizations and even schools all over the country take part in this. And millions of dollars has been raised, and millions of cans of food have been donated. And I would like for us to pray over this food and to bless it for those who will receive it. And if you would, come over here close to the table for me. Can you do that? And just lay your hands on the table. We also have bags of food down here on the floor that have food that came in this morning that didn't get put on the display. So we have a lot to donate. Will you repeat after me? And the congregation can follow along. Gracious God.
Gracious God.
Thank you for all the food.
Thank you for all the food.
You provide for us each day. Be with those who are hungry. And help us to meet their needs. By sharing what we have. Bless those who will eat this food. May it remind them of your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Donna. This time we have the opportunity, the blessings and gift God has blessed us to return to God. Please stand for our offering to be presented to God. Scripture reading.
First Corinthians 3:1-9. Brothers and sisters, I could not address you as people who live by the Spirit, but as people who are still worldly. Near infants in Christ, I gave you milk, not swallowed food, for you were not ready for it. Indeed, you are still not ready. You are still worldly, for since there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not worldly? Are you not acting like mere humans? For when one says, I follow Paul, and another, I follow Apollos, are you not a mere human being? What, after all, is Apollos, and what is Paul? Only servants through whom you came to believe. As the Lord has assigned to each his task, I planted the seed, Apollos watered it, but God has been making it grow. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who makes things grow. The one who plants and the one who waters have one purpose, and they will each be rewarded according to their own labor. For we are co-workers in God's service. You are God's field, God's building. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Brother. I'd like to pray together before we have God's message. Especially, please pray together for our sick members who are named in the church bulletin. Let us pray. God of love and mercy, you have called us and all your children into one family through the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. By his gracious presence, we look with new eyes at the whole human family in its brokenness and pain. We seek your strength and determination to embrace them, love them, heal them, and share with them your great good news of hope and new life. Hear us as we lift to our deepest needs, our pressing burdens, our fears and hopes. Be near us, we pray, as your people. Help us to receive your many gifts with gratitude and faithful stewardship. We pray for those who suffer pain or illness, for the lonely and despairing, for the lost and worn and battered of our world. And we lift you, the leaders of this and every nation, community, and faith, that they would be guided by your Spirit and aware of the needs, especially of the least of their people. To the sick, O Lord, give your healing. To the grief, give hope. To the dying, give your peace. And to all of us, O God, give faith to live in the light of your good news in Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, as you share your message and listen, we pray for your divine anointing on us. Please open our hearts to hear the message that you give us. Please be with us from the beginning to the end of our worship. It is in his name that we offer to you our prayer and our lives. Amen. I pray that God's grace and peace be with you while we sharing the God's message this morning. Today's Bible passage is about the maturity of our faith before God. The Apostle Paul compares worldly wisdom and divine wisdom in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and 2. The wisdom of God is to accept and believe in the ministry of Jesus on the cross to save us. Paul said that worldly wisdom does not accept God's wisdom because worldly people regard God's wisdom as foolishness. Those who receive God's wisdom rely on and listen to God and do not listen to Satan's negative message. Through today's Bible passage, Apostle Paul goes one step further and speaks about the maturing faith. Paul identifies what it is to be deeper and stronger in faith. Through today's scripture, I'd like to share with you what kind of person Paul is talking about as a mature person in faith and how faith grows in God. In Paul's eyes, the faith of the Corinthian church was immature, like a kid who does not eat solid food but only drinks milk. Parents will be concerned and worried if their child is unable to eat solid food and only consumes milks every day. Christians cannot continue to make the same mistakes. We have to get better and eat solid food of faith. After a believer is born again, their faith must continue to grow. If we don't grow, the Lord will look at us with a worrying gaze. On the other hand, if we are maturing in the stature of the fullness of Christ, God will be pleased with our growth. Paul describes such an immature person as worldly, who is controlled by the sinful nature. Other biblical versions also describe the Corinthians as being controlled by ordinary impulses. It refers to a person who goes to the church but lives according to sinful nature. As Christians, we should remember that even the devil acknowledges Christ. That if, after being saved and gaining a new life, you have not grown and your thought and life have not changed into God's way, you are not moving onto solid fruit. There are characteristics of this immature faith. This worldly person may attend the church, but is not following God's commands. A worldly person does not resemble Jesus Christ. They are not guided by Holy Spirit. They do not live a God-centered life, but self-centered life. They do not follow God's will, but speak and act according to their own desire and emotions. All of these descriptions do not refer to someone outside the church. It unfortunately describes an immature person within the church. When a person still has worldly attributes, that person is jealous of others and causes strife in the church. The word envy comes from Latin and means to look closely. It is said that envy begins with looking at others with evil, negative eyes. It is the mind that wants to bring down and destroy the other. So naturally, jealousy causes dispute and conflict within the church. The Lord commanded us, love your neighbors as yourself. We believers are to love our neighbors according to the command of our Lord. But rather than following the command of the Lord, the person with worldly attributes follows their own thought or feeling. Jealousy does not let us grow before God, because jealousy is the sin of loving only oneself. If it focuses only on the self, and then this person uses their life to destroy others instead of working on their own growth. They pull others down when they see someone with better condition than themselves. If they think their neighbors has better talents and gifts than they have, they will fail to praise and encourage others. In the end, they are envious, jealous, demeaning, and accusatory of others. Those who belong to the flesh, worldly, live a life distortion. If believers belong to the flesh and are jealous, there will be naturally division in the church. The Corinthian church formed a group and fought against each other. As we shared the last time, the church in Corinth was divided into group of Paul's followers and Apollos' followers and etc. In the Corinthian church, they competed and fought for more power and influence. Some says in the Corinthian church that they are better because they were taught by Paul, Apostle Paul, who founded the Corinthian church. Others says that Apollos preaches better and is more popular than Paul, so they are better. Envy toward others creates competition and conflict in the church. Outwardly, they claim to follow Paul and Apollos, but in fact, they pursue their own greed and use their names as a tool to attack others. Korean churches divide members into small groups and gather weekly to worship in small groups for membership spiritual growth. The purpose being together as a small group to meditate on Word of God and share their spiritual insight and praise together in small group. However, some would gather in small group and share God's word for 10 minutes, then gossip about other groups for 30 minutes. There are many, many other wonderful and spiritual churches in Korea. Actually, we have biggest church in the world in South Korea.
Oh, wow.
But there are also problems everywhere. This kind of behavior is very serious. The purpose of gathering in a small group is to share the God's word. But what kind of church small group is it that gathers and gossips about others? They simply get together to cause others, but after a while, they fought amongst themselves in the very same group. The purpose of church is to gather as children of God, worship together, and work for the kingdom of God within one heart. But what kind of church would it be if we gather together and caused others? When people who belong to the flesh cause envy and dispute in the church body of Christ is torn, dirty, and scarred. Do we not then speak and act like those who belong to flesh, like a Corinthian church? That is too sickening and destroy the church. If such a thing ever happens, we must repent before God. Then what kind of person belongs to the spiritually mature that pleases God? A person who belongs to the Spirit means a spiritually mature believer in today's scripture. Those who belong to a spiritual do not live according to desire of the flesh. What are the desires of the flesh controlled by the simple nature? Galatians chapter 5, verse 19 to 21 says it well. So it's a bit long verses, but I'd like to read it together. The act of the simple nature are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. However, those who belong to the Spirit are those who live according to the Spirit and bear the fruit of the Spirit. What are the fruit of the Spirit? The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Much of believers show these fruits of the Holy Spirit in their lives. We are not saved by our behavior, our good deed, but it is clear that the believer who is saved bears the fruits of the Holy Spirit in their lives. And there is a basic condition for faith to grow and produce the fruits of the Holy Spirit. Bible says, "So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God." Ultimately, those who belong to the Spirit are those who follow the Bible, the Word of God. They discover God's will in the Bible and obey it and apply it to their lives. I hope that we too can become people who belong to the Spirit, who are mature believers, who are able to concern God's will in the Bible. The book Jesus CEO using ancient wisdom for visionary leadership by Lori Beth Jones is a bestseller book. In the book, the author argues that Jesus had a deep sense of purpose and direction that served as an inner anchor throughout his life and ministry. This anchor, allowed Jesus to remain focused and steadfast even in the face of adversity and opposition. Jesus had an inner anchor that could not be shaken under any circumstances. What is our inner anchor today? What sustains us to be unshakable no matter what anyone says against us? That is God's Word. We are not God incarnated like Jesus Christ, but we have Jesus within us and with us in spirit and God's Word. When believers have a strong inner anchor, God's Word, we are better equipped to navigate the challenges and uncertainties of the worldly. I believe that only God's Word, Bible, will keep us from being washed away by the harsh wave of this world and will hold us to port of God's eternal hope. We must anchor our heart in God's Word and use it to mature in Him. There is no reason to envy and fight over who is greater in the church. This is because we all walk faithfully in our respective ministry, and each of us will be rewarded for our own labor. We are not rewarded for doing more than others in church. Let's read verse 8 together.
The man who plants and the man who waters have one purpose, and each will be rewarded according to his own labor.
Amen. In this verse, each will be rewarded in the end according to our own labor. Both Paul, who built the Corinthian church, and Apollos, who made it grow, will receive a reward in heaven. In addition, the members of the church who served diligently are also rewarded according to their labor. I bless all of us to root our faith in the Word of God and become mature believer. So I bless you to become a person of faith who is rewarded by God in heaven. I grew up in the countryside of South Korea. I went to a small elementary school like Kataba Elementary. And while I was in elementary school, I felt really good when I received an award from the school. I remember receiving a perfect attendance award. I won to receive a prize in heaven too. That's why I keep doing my ministry. I started a church ministry while in college, doing children's Sunday school and read various worship service. However, the pastor's wage was not sufficient to live on, so there was times when I wanted to do something other than ministry. I could have lived a more financially stable life if I did another job, but I did ministry to obey the calling God has given me, and I believe there will be a reward for me according to my obedience. When God sent me to Catawba, I believed that God had a plan for me, so I obeyed and came to this place. I believe that there are souls that God will send me to take care of. And I believe that there will be things from God's word that He will want me to preach to this congregation. And through this, I believe to ultimately receive a reward in heaven for faithfulness. If I am faithful, even in the place with different culture and language, God will reward me. I want to be rewarded by the Lord when I go to heaven. I hope all of you will be rewarded in heaven, those who devote themselves to share love and serving, and those who are zealous in prayer and preach the gospel, will all be rewarded in heaven. God will reward the church where ministers and believers gather their heart and support each other. And I hope we can meet in heaven and show each other's words and rejoice together. In the second half of verse 8, God says, each will be rewarded according to his or her own labor. I'd like to see what I have done for Christ and the church. So in heaven, we will receive the reward of reconciliation, prize of fruits of the Holy Spirit, an award of faithful ministry, an award of mature Christian, an award of faith rooted in the Word. And some people might receive something like Korean Pastor's Helper Award in heaven. We should not spend our lives comparing ourselves to others. We believe that we will grow as we focus our lives on the Word of God, our inner anchor. At that time, I strongly believe we will be rewarded as a good and faithful servant of God on the last day in heaven. I look forward to meet with all of you again in heaven and receiving a reward with you in heaven, and rejoice it together in heaven. Friends, this is all said in the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Would you rise, if you are able, let us affirm our faith as found in the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us close our time together in Him as we sing hymn number 694. Number 694. Come ye thankful people, come. Children who cannot eat the word of God and grow up, but let us grow by obeying the word of God. At the time, I believe that, we believe that, we will be rewarded by God as mature believers, free from the sense of comparison to others. May the grace of God grow in our faith and be with us. Father, as we dismiss, may the peace of God the Father, the grace of Jesus the Son, the guidance and communion of the Holy Spirit be with you, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.